Well, good morning, everyone. And welcome to worship on this Palm Sunday at Fairfax United Methodist Church. We're delighted to be with you this morning. And to all of you who are worshiping with us online, we say hello to you. We know you're there, and we're glad that you decided to join us this morning. We just want to remind you that our endowment grant applications are going to be due March 28th. So if you have an idea for ministry or something that you would like to do in the work of the church, you can put in an application to our endowment committee for funds to do that. And there are lots of ways that you can serve and take care of our community and our church. So please move forward with that because they are due soon. We remind you that we have a busy week this week. We have our Table to Cross service this Thursday at 7 p.m., where we move from the Last Supper all the way to the cross. You can come for one service from 7 o'clock. And then on Friday, we have Stations of the Cross from 7 a.m. until 7 p.m., and all of these windows will be transformed to look like stained glass, and you will have a self-directed opportunity to go around with some devotions and a booklet that we'll give you. You'll be able to pray, you'll be able to light candles, and you'll have a moment, sometimes of meditation and reflection on all that the Savior did for you. And importantly, we want you to know that Easter is coming, and we have three worship services for you. This 6 a.m. sunrise service, which you will be able to enjoy in the Old Town Square right here in Fairfax City. The youth will be putting on this service. It's a beautiful service with the sunrise coming up as we worship. And there are about at least 60 to 70 people who come, so we hope you'll join us either for that or our 9:30 or 11 o'clock service here at in the sanctuary. And now let us prepare our hearts for worship. Please stand for our call to worship. Give thanks to God, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Hosanna. We give thanks to God who answers us, for God is our saving help. The stone the builders rejected is now the cornerstone. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. All give us, Lord, Hosanna. Let us sing now hymn number 278, Hosanna, Hosanna, loud Hosanna. Thank you. Almighty and everlasting God, as we bring our gifts and lay them at your altar, we remember the crowds in Jerusalem who laid their cloaks on the road, shouting, Hosanna, and Jesus passed. We know they were looking for a Messiah who was different from whom you sent as Jesus, not one of political power, but one who came in compassion and mercy. Search our hearts that we might be confident that the Messiah for whom we long has come. Jesus Christ, your anointed one, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Come, weary pilgrim, kneel and remember, rest in the silence of this sacred place. Search through the shadows, Jesus is waiting. Portrait of grace. Come and remember, come and remember. Come see his portrait of grace.
Jesus stood above the great city and wept. Through the morning mist, he could see the ancient gates of Jerusalem. In the stillness of the moment, he remembered the prophets who had gone before him. Throughout the centuries, their noble words of promise called out again and again, but they were too often drowned out by the noise of hatred and violence. Like a parent longing for a wandering child, his spirit ached to gather the people safely to his side, like a faithful shepherd caring for his flock. He wanted to hold them close to his heart and shelter them in his arms of grace. The sun rose higher in the sky, and the road to Jerusalem stretched out before him. He began to walk. Fully knowing the path ahead was paved with sorrow, but such was the power of his great love for the people. He must go to them and speak the words of promise again. The truth must once again ring through the winding streets of the city. Through his tears of compassion, he saw large crowds of people coming to meet him. They were waving palms and shouting praises. The people for the moment had seen a great light, and they rushed to welcome their promised king.
Oh,
flickering candles cast long shadows upon the walls of the upper room as Jesus gathered with the disciples for the Passover feast. In this humble sanctuary, the King of Kings, the Creator of all life, knelt before his creation and washed the feet of his followers. Becoming a servant, the Son of God displayed the true nature of love as he comforted his friends. As it grew time for the Passover meal to be served, Jesus shared with his chosen ones the very heart of his mission. "This is my body given for you." The disciples watched in wonder as the Savior lifted a chalice of wine. "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant shed for the redemption of many." It was there in a simple room made of stone that a new portrait of grace was given to the world.
Gethsemane was a special place of quiet and solitude for Jesus. He would often go there to pray and be silent among the beauty of his creation. Following the Passover meal, Jesus and the disciples once again walked through the gates of the garden. Seeking comfort and refuge, they quieted themselves beneath a canopy of olive trees. The sylvan shadows of the grove crept across the ground as the evening grew deep. With the night falling hard around them, the disciples fell asleep while Jesus fell to the ground in agony. "Father, take this cup from me," he cried into the silent night. "If there be another way, take from me this bitter wine." His tearful cry rang out across the valley in lonesome echoes of sorrow and pain. As the earth caught his sweat drops of blood, Jesus surrendered his heart to the Father's will and embraced his calling. Suddenly, the golden stars shining in the distance became torches of violence. Led by Judas, armed centurions burst into the sanctuary of the garden looking for Jesus. "Father, let thy will be done," he spoke as he rose to face his destiny.
Jesus was brought into the praetorium and stood before Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor. Though Pilate could find no just reason to detain Jesus, he acquiesced to the frenzied crowd and gave Jesus over to be executed. Taken from the courts, Jesus was beaten and then forced to carry a heavy wooden cross up a winding path to a place known as Golgotha, the place of the skull. There, outside the city's walls, Christ's battered body was nailed to crude timbers and raised into place. A strange stillness blanketed the land as the Lamb of God began to die. With outstretched arms, the Savior embraced the world with an everlasting love. With each whispered word, he proclaimed forgiveness and kindness. Unbounded grace flowed from his heart and baptized the barren soil around the cross with scarlet promise. "Father, forgive them," he cried into the shadows. The heavens echoed in reply with rolls of living thunder. Standing like a mighty tower of strength, the cross reconciled heaven and earth once again. The ancient wounds were healed, and the scars of sin were banished forever. For it is written, "Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. He was wounded for our transgressions, and with his stripes we are healed."
Thank you. As Jesus hung in the cruel embrace of the cross, he reached out to his mother with great tenderness and love. Even as he was covered with the sorrows of grief, the sorrows and grief of a sinful world, his heart broke for his mother's sadness. In his compassion, he asked John to care for her. As Mary watched her son's life ebb away, she remembered all of the miracles and wonders of his incredible life. She remembered the day the angel spoke to her and how her fear was turned to joy. She remembered the evening in Bethlehem in the stable as she gazed upon his beautiful eyes and sang a mother's first lullaby. She could still see him running down the path as a young boy. "Look how tall he has become. He'll become a man in no time," she said to Joseph. She remembered dreaming about his future, this miracle son. "When you are grown, you will lay your hands on wood, just like your father," she remembered telling him. Suddenly, her reverie was broken. "It is finished," he cried from the cross. "Father, into your care I commend my spirit." Overwhelmed by grief, she looked into his eyes one last time as they closed in death. After they took Jesus down from the cross, Mary held him one final time and washed his wounds with her tears.
I want to give voice to the gratitude that is in all our hearts for what we have experienced about Passion Week through music and song. First of all, I want to make sure I thank our guest musicians. Thank you for being here today, and thank you for your talents that you bring to bless us with this morning. Also, I want to thank our readers, Anne, Eva, Olive, John, and David. Thank you for reading those words that have blessed us. And I want to thank our choir, including our George Mason students and guests who are with us this morning. Thank you. And we are always grateful for our talented and gifted organist and pianist, Hyun Young. Thank you, Hyun. And for the one who put it all together, we're so grateful for our choir and music director, Mike Horansky. Thank you, Mike. And thanks to you, it's not Palm Sunday without a crowd. For those who are here in person and those who are online, we're so grateful for your presence this morning. And especially thanks be to God the Father, the Almighty, who gave us his Son, that we may live abundantly and eternally. Let us turn to God in prayer. God of human gifts and graces, we thank you for this special day of worship that has served as a hallowed vehicle to move us through Jesus' triumphant entry to his passion. Through the words, songs, and instruments, we have been blessed to receive this great story of redemption, of how much you love all people through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our hearts, souls, and minds have been inspired, and our faith deepened as recipients of this holy experience of worship. We give you thanks. God of great compassion, we are ever mindful of those who need your touch of divine intervention. We pray for those who are sick, recovering from medical procedures, those facing treatment, those who struggle with mental and emotional challenges, and those who feel great anxiety about the changes of life. As we pray for your healing and peace, may we be good friends to those who are in need. God of the journey, prepare us for this Holy Week as we too follow the way of the cross, so that an Easter of unending joy we may obtain at last in the life you have given, a life that is abundant and eternal. This we pray through the name that is above all names, the Savior of humankind, the Prince of Peace and Judge of all nations, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please stand as you are able and comfortable. Our closing hymn is number 301, Jesus, Keep Me Near the Cross. as you begin the journey of Holy Week, may you find the love and mercy that God, through his Son, Jesus Christ, has for you. And with that knowledge in your mind and in your heart, may you go forth in peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.